Now, the question is, how do we start this technology? We have to start a genome sequencing, what approach we have to do, how do we have to take this approach, and what are the requirements on that, and what level we have an understanding once we generate these kind of the data. So these are the various platforms you use. One is called Massive Parallel DNA Sequencing platform. You have a three different platform, which is called as a Roche 454. You have a Illumina, and you have a Solid Applied Biosystems, and then you have a Sanger 373GO. So in a Sanger, what you do is, you do the back-end sequencing, you create a back library of your plant, which you are planning to sequence, and then you do the back-end sequencing by using Sanger. So you have around 100, the back containing 150 KB of the fragment, and if you sequence the back-end, so you know that the forward reaction and the reverse reaction of this back is separated by 150 KB. So you have to know that this is called a pair end of 150 KB data you are generating from the back. Similarly, you have a shotgun and parent by using, and how do you generate this? How do you generate this data? The first thing is, you need to create a back library at which have a size of 100, or on an average it comes 150 KB. You have various options to sequence the backs, so you either can have a 5 to 6x coverage to make these backs overlapping fragment. And if you want to sequence these backs, you have a various options. Either you can use a 3840 or 2840 at a 30x coverage. And then what you do is you take your high molecular weight of the DNA, you shear this DNA into various fragments, do the size selections, and you subclone it to the back. Later on to that, and you make your back library in 96 or 380 format sequence, isolate the DNA and sequence those backs. So you generate the sequencing data on the back. It's very essential to do any plant genome sequencing because plant genome are too complex. The first platform which we are talking about, it is called as the Roche 454 or GSFLX. It's a long read platform. The advantage of this platform is you have an 800 to 1000 base pair sequence data you have been generating. So I'm going to show you what the data is required. So the first very simplest part, you have your genomic DNA, you make your template library the first. And in making a template library, you take either have a shotgun approach or either you have a pair-end approach. In the shotgun approach, you take the DNA, genomic DNA, fragment into 500 to 800 base pair and polish that, and then you fill in these gaps and then you do a EPCR and then this library is made. If you're going the parent library, it doesn't mean you have to sequence at 2 to 4 KB depending on the kind of library you're preparing, 2 KB, 3 KB, 4 KB, 5 KB, 6 KB, 8 KB, 20 KB, whatever the library you are making. So you shear the fragment into those sizes. Suppose if I'm making a 20 KB library, I sheared my genomic DNA into the 20 KB, I end polish these DNA, make a hairpin into that, do the digestions, circularize the gains, and then you get the 500 to 800 base pair fragment. So these fragments are representing the end of these two wherever. And this means these two ends, when you're sequencing this, generating this data, indicating that these two fragments will be paired at a 20 KB. The light of the glow will be happening at this time, and the glow will be correlated with the particular nucleotide flow into the system, and that's how you generate the data. And when you generate the data, you have a data in a FASTA format, a quality score is associated, and then you start assembling that various part of the data, which I'm going to cover into next slides. The second technology is the Illumina. The pattern is the same. I'm going to give you one glimpse where you have a comparison between, straight away comparison between three technology and how these three technology differing from one to each other. The second is, same manners, you take your genomic DNA, you sear your genomic DNA, and you make your adapters here. And here, there what we did, we did the emulsion PCR, and emulsion PCR, we did one read, one DNA. And we attach the DNA of whatever the size we have created random. Searing we have done it here. Randomly we have add the adapters, and these adapters containing the sequence of the interest here will be attached here. So we are creating on a beam. Here we are creating on a slides. So this is directly going to attach to the slides, and you are amplifying directly on a slide. You are not creating any version or any beam. And this is called as a cluster generation, and these clusters will be directly sequencing to get the data. So what is happening once you generate the cluster, each cluster is representing a one single unique molecule. And you start reading the sequencing from one end to the another end. And what is happening, suppose if I'm just looking into this particular slides, so this is the flow we are looking into, that this is one particular cluster which is represented here. So each flow of the nucleotide is just termination-based chemistry, where normal base is going to come there. The base is going to be ligate over there, and there will be a growth associated, and the last it will be trimmed off. So the normal backgrounds will come back. So what is happening here? The first read you have a G, then you have a C, then you have a P, then you have a D. So same cluster is growing differently when the nucleotide is flowing in that, and you keep on attaching the sequence in that, and then you generate the data. The third platform is called as the SOLID, which is used as a mate pair chemistry sequencing in the plant genomes. where you take your genomic DNA, shear your genomic DNA, add your adapter, and this will represent how your the fragment size. If you have a 1 kb fragment, 2 kb, 3 kb, 4 kb, 5 kb, this is representing the same size which you are fragmenting here. And when you say 1 kb fragment, you don't have a 1 kb, you have a plus minus 200 base pair. So you are talking about your 1 kb library, you are talking about 800 base pair to 1.2 kb of these libraries. And once you digest your DNA from here, you have a 50 base this side and 50 base this side. And once you add your adapter, once you sequence both the ends, you know that my tag is, these two tags are separated to each other by 1 kb because I have created 1 kb library. If I have created 2 kb library, so these two tags will be separated by 2 kb. I am going to show you how this look like into when we are talking about the sampling. So once you generate the beads, here also we have to generate the beads containing the DNA by emulsion PCR in a similar fashion there. So if you compare the three different technology, the Roche 454, you have a library preparation, you have a bead preparation, and then you have a sequencing by pyrosequencing method. In a second, you have a library preparation, you do not generate a bead, but directly generate a cluster on slides. And the third technology, you make a library and you make a bead and put it on a glass slide. There, you are putting on a 44 micron groove which will be specifically deposited here on a normal glass slide which are having a specific attachment which attach these beads to the glass slides. So what is this? Is a chemistry is called as the sequencing by ligations. This is how it is called, ligation detections method, oligo ligation sequencing by oligo ligation detection. This is how the name solid is there. So these are the probes. What they have done is they have created a octamer probes. These probes will come and sit into this, and the ligase enzymes will come and do the sealing of this activity, and then there will be excitations will happen, fluorescence will be detected, and the sequencing will be done. The advantage of this technology, you have a short link here. The first technology generate 400 to 800 base pair. The second technology generate 100 base pair, 250 base pair, and this generate 75 base pair data, 50 into 25, so 75 base pair data it generate from this technology. So once you generate this data, the important part is why this technology is more superior in terms of the SNP discovery. Because if you look at this base, it interrogates each base twice. If you look at 1 and 2, in a first primer, this base 1 is interrogated. In the second primer also, the base is interrogated. So each time you are interrogating each base twice, and that's how it make more preciseness into accuracy in terms of when you are detecting SNP. There is no system error, so very minimal system error will be introduced in terms of that. So what you are ultimately after, you have various cycle of collection data, excitations, collections of data, image and processing. So ultimately you want to get the sequence here. So what you have a color space sequence which is coming into in the next slides, and then you want to convert this space sequence into that. This is the matrix which convert this color space into the sequences. So if you say AT, BG, GG, GA, and when you convert into the sequence, T read twice, you have a T, G read twice, you have a G, G read twice, you have a G. Suppose if there is a real SNP here, there will be two consecutive changes will be there. If it is an artifact, only one change is there, the system will detect and remove these reads because this is a single change. It is not allowed because you have, these base has to be represented by previous color and the next color. And this is how you read these base twice. So if you look at the data format, how this data format for three platform, this is the first platform which we have discussed. Data format is coming to the FNA, it's called a FASTA format, and quality file, you have a sequence and then you have a quality file associated with that. You have a, here also similar to the second platforms, this is called FASTQ format, where you have a FASTA plus quality file associated with that. When you read back into that, you will come back to the quality of these particular files. Here also, this is the quality, it's called quality file, and sequence is in a CS FASTA. It's a color space FASTA. So it is not a direct nucleotide sequence FASTA, it is in a color space FASTA which comes in a 0, 1, 2, 3 kind of matrix, and this 0, 1, 2, 3 matrix will be defined by these parameters. That 0 indicate all AA, GG, CC, DD is represented by the 0, and you have a similar for 1, 2, 3. So this is how they decode the sequences from 0, 1, 2, 3. And this quality value, we cannot compare these two quality value directly because this is a quality score value. When you multiply this, it comes maybe 30 or 40 quality. Suppose if it is a 32 base quality value score, it goes 65 or 70 at this position. So this is a color space quality value, not a nucleotide space quality value. You have to convert back this value into the nucleotide space value. So what are the challenges into the plant genome sequencing? The first thing is the genome polymorphism. You have a various ploidy regions into the genomes. You have a large scale duplications and deletions, duplications, repeats, lot of mismatch are there generated into the assembly. These are the various, even transposons also create a lot of problems into the assembly. So these are the various approaches generally you need to address when you are assembling the plant genomes. So how do you handle these kind of the repeats? That's how we have been using three different platforms into the three different areas. We've been using a various program to carry out the sequencing by using the long reads, by using parent reads, by using the wet pair reads and a various size 2 kb, 3 kb, 6 kb so that you can resolve all these problems during the assembly. May not be 100% but at a confident level you will be able to have 80-85% of your assembly be correct in a proper way. So what you do is, these are the various parts important, so you need to handle the repeat detections. So various programs are there to handle the repeat detections. So pre-assembly you identify what these repeats are there. You have a repeat master and other part to understand how these repeats are working in close related genome and how you want to handle these repeats into your genome, what kind of the strategy you want to make it. And then the second one is how do you resolve these repeats. These are very important part. So we have a various methodology which I'm going to express you. So if you want to sequence a genome, suppose if there's 300 MB genome, 700 MB genome or 1500 MB genome, so what kind of the data do you require to generate into that? You need a shotgun data, you need a parent data, this is the long read technology. Then you need to have a data from HiSeq, which will be there, maybe 50x, 50x of 300 base pair, 500 base pair, 2 kb, 4 kb, 5 kb. Then you have 150 base pair, 1 kb and 6 kb. If you look at that, we are covering from 150, 300, 500, 2 kb, 1 kb, 2 kb, and then we have 4 kb, 5 kb and 6 kb. The reason why, because each technology have a limitations in a resourcing and resolving all these problems which I was talking about earlier. And these are the very important part to play when we are talking about throughput, because these are the throughput data. Here, to generate a 50x data at a pair end will take a huge amount of money, because each run is costing 8 lakhs to 10 lakhs rupees. So very expensive projects to run onto that. So you need to balance between these technology. You have to have a long read, and then you ultimately have to add some back cloning into that. So you have a 5x back, so you generate some number of the backs here, sequence some 5 and with both of the sites, and you generate this data. So this data now will be help you to make a scaffolding of the genomes. I'm going to show you how the scaffolding will be done. But then another is, how do you define this in a chromosomes? So chromosomes, you need to have a physical map. And then you take these scaffolds and do the physical mapping and put onto the chromosome. If you do not have a physical map, the next thing is, you take these scaffolds, then you make a probe from these scaffold and then do the in situ hybridizations on the same cell. And then you check it out, which chromosome this scaffold is going on, and then you start assembling across the chromosomes. But in a research purpose, if you are really looking to defining as in a chromosome wise, you can do that, or you can use both the information together using the in situ hybridization approach as well as the scaffolding approach, and then you can define that which scaffold is going to the which chromosomes, and you can create a chromosome wise information on that. Second information is, you can take a closely related species, you know that already, because that's already been sequenced. You have already marker defined in a positions which may be enough less than a centimorgan, and then you can start mapping those marker, identifying those marker in this genome, sequence assembly scaffold, and then you start mapping those scaffold back into the chromosome. There are various approaches to resolve those issues. So how the assembly will happen? In a genome assembly, you have a various platforms data, which we already discussed. You have a various assembler. We've been working with the NuBlur. We have a different pipelines already been associated. With the NuBlur, we have a Velvet, Soft De Novo, we have a Ray assembler, we have a Abyss assembler, we have a CLC assembler. And then you create your the first scaffold. Scaffold is nothing but is a large context with the various many context comes together and make the larger sequence, which is called a scaffold, may be separated by N or may not be separated by N, depending on how the contexts are being covering, overlapping or not overlapping. If the contexts are non-overlapping, then it will be having an N, so that is called as a scaffold containing N. And if it is overlapping contexts are coming together, then it is called as the normal scaffold without N. So you generate a scaffold, then you use the backend sequencing along with that and wet pair and Illumina parent. And this is how the scaffold will come back into the second Cap3 assembly. You have a larger scaffold, which is called as a long range scaffold, and then you gap fill between these scaffold by using again the backend sequence, full length backend sequencing data, and then you come back to the very long scaffold, maybe MBs and GPs. these are the various programs, and these are the various type of the applications, and then there is technology which use the various data set. Every program cannot take every data sets. Suppose if you say the Ray assembler does not take the solid data, but NewGraph can take the solid data, CLC branch can take, Velvet can take. So these are the various combinations of the program. What kind of the algorithm generally we use? One is called an overlayout consensus sequence, and another is a debugging graph. In an overlayout algorithm based on the graph theory, the graph is constructed, nodes or the reads are there. I'll show you how it will happen. And as a representative in an overlapping reads, this is called an overlapping layout. Debugging, you make an keyword. Suppose if you have a sequence which is started from 1 to 50 base pair, for example, or 1 to 100 base pair. So how do you generate a keyword? The first sequence, I want to generate a 29 keyword. So the first my keyword is a sequence is 1 to 29. The second will be 2 to 30. The third will be 3 to 31. Like it keep on generating the first keyword, and then it keep on starting assembling each other. And this is how the sequence has been assembled. So how the de novo assembly will be carried out? You have a sequence. Either you sequence the full length, create a fragment. Either you sequence the end. You have an pair end. Various size of the pair end you have in your library. Then this is called as an pair end sequencing. You know this end and this end, and you already know because you have sheared the DNA with the known size, whether it is a 1 kb, 2 kb, 20 kb. Right. So this is called an insert length, and then you start working, you generate all these data sets which are there, you do not know where it is happening. These are the data sets, you start assembling this particular data set, this come into the various overlapping fashion, some of the independent pair labs, some of them as an overlapping fashions. Then you start recalling back, this is called as an contig. So contig has been generated, then you take the pair and data on these contigs, and you start mapping these contigs. So you know already the parent. So this is the one end. So if this I have generated a 20 kb parent, so this read is at this position. So the second read has to be 20 kb apart from there. And this is how you resolve the contigs. So these are the two contigs which are falling into that. So this one read is mapping in a contig 1, another read is mapping in a contig 2, this read is mapping in contig 1, this is mapping in contig 3. So now if I do that, this whole thing is called as a scaffold. Here there is no overlapping region, so this will become as an N. So this is called as the N related scaffold. Suppose if I go to another contig, it will be blink here, and this is how you get in your assembly. So you have a genome, you have sheared, you have generated the data in contigs, you link these contigs together and create the scaffolding of that particular genome. Now, this scaffold, now we left in the gap. As I told you, there will be many scaffolds, 3000, 5000 scaffold, but there will be a gap. How do you resolve? Two types of gap, one is called physical gap and it's called sequencing gap. Physical gap, you cannot do anything on that because you cannot sequence those gaps because of the high repeated region, or it is a problem with the sequencing because of the incorrect orientations or the overlapping problems. So you have two different types of gap. When you assemble your data, you can visualize your assembly, and when you are visualizing your assembly, you can work it out how your sequence are being arranged from one to another, and you can visualize the sequence, you can visualize the amino acids, you can visualize the chemical. These are the contigs which have been generated, various length of these contigs, and then the various amino acids you can work out in the visualization part. The next part is come is how to validate this assembly. So whatever we have assembled, are these assembly are correct, or there are some problems. So you start validating. So validation means you have to first find out the row reads which you have already generated, take these scaffold, map these reads back into the scaffold, and see whether you will be properly able to map or not. Suppose if you are not able to map, that means that the scaffold is misassembled. You have to resolve that misassembly by taking out that particular contigs, and then you have to resolve, create some gap into that, and wherever the misassembly are there, you have to do that. The second is comparison of two assembly made by a different assembler, and the third is the average coverage per base per contigs. So this will tell you out what is happening on that. This is one of the case examples where you have a number of contigs, your number of scaffold, total base generated, maximum number of mean length of these scaffold. These are the fungal genomes which you have been assembled. The next part is how do you do the annotations? You have to understand what this particular genome is going to tell us. So you want to understand that what functions it has, so you take a scaffold by scaffold, start annotating. So generally in the genome sequencing program, whether you take a potato or any other genome sequencing program, so let me see, many programs are there with genome sequencing is going on chromosome by chromosome, but still they are working into the same manner. They are getting a scaffold and rotating these scaffold, deciphering the important function which are required for these.